So I hope that you have heard one or two things that might be interesting to you this week, I mean, today. And I hope that he that has here has heard or will hear. Then the word. Let me talk to my friends in on Facebook for a few minutes. Then I want Abiola to come forward, if he's there. Hello, everybody in Facebook, on Facebook. How are you? I don't forget you guys. You see, I'm coming back to check on you once in a while, even though I'm so busy here with my with my class. First of all, let's give you a round of applause. From the child to Chris. I can hear you. Well, that's our HMT class. Joy and rejoicing. I hope they got something. We'll hear from them soon. But before then, I want to call upon all of you who are watching now to go and share the link. Go and share the links to this program. I believe that this should be a blessing to a lot of people wherever they are watching or wherever they are going to watch. And when you are going to share the link, please don't just share the link, but make sure you write something as well. Write some comments. Write your opinion, your thinking. If you think that this is worth it to watch this program, let the people know who are going to see it that they should watch it. And I think that all of you need to actually have a copy of this message, because the copy of it will enable you to be able to watch it again and again. And the way to do that is to share it. When you share it, the copy will come to your timeline, and you'll be able to watch it again. So let's go and share before we begin to hear some of the testimonies from our brethren here. Okay, now, you know, you people are students, eh? I want to use the example of Abiola to show you that even as you are students, you could either be rich or poor. Abiola was one of the people, he had never been here. This is your first time in my house, huh? No. First HMT, yeah. He had never been here before when he heard that Pastor Sunday was giving job to some people to help him convert his books to, messages to books. And I don't know why he decided that he could write. But when I got his book, the one he did, I discovered, what even gave this guy the idea to even suggest himself? Because he's not a writer and he cannot write anything. Because with the thing he wrote, I just returned it. I just said, I don't want to break his spirit. So I advised Pastor Clement that he recommended him. And I said, just tell that guy that it's okay, he has tried. He has tried, that is enough. But the guy refused to give up. I told him, the work you've done is not good enough. He said, I will try again. I said, okay, I know that it will not work, but you try again. He tried again, and I returned it again. I said, it will still not work. It's not good enough. He tried again, and I returned it again. But I saw his zeal, and I began to pity him. I said, this guy is so full of zeal. So I decided to pity him. So what my solution? I said, okay, I have trained other people, Charles and Lyle. They know what I need, how to write for me now. So you go and split the money I was supposed to pay you, $2,000, split it between them, give them half and take half so that they will help you to correct and to whatever effort you have done and to help you. The guy said, no, if I have done a bad job, let pastor correct me, but I'm going to keep on trying until I make it. I said, can a person be so determined like that? So I said, okay, let him keep on trying, but I know it will not work out. Today, he's about to finish the third book. He's about to finish the third book in a few months. And he has now discovered that he thought $2,000 that I was supposed to pay him was the reason why he wanted to come. But now he has discovered that money is the least, is the most insignificant thing he is getting in the process of working with me. That money is like, he said in his own words, it's like you are training me and paying me for it. That is what he said. So I would like us to welcome Abiola, Dr. Tobi Abiola. And, please sit down and shoot him. Let him tell us his story. Or maybe you can come here, Abiola, so that you can sit in your place.
I think I will stand. Okay.
Yeah, because Fran needs to sit down there.
Okay, for me. Thank you very much, sir. I'm really humbled. Actually, some months ago, it was Ms. Susayo that actually just gave me a call around 11 p.m. And I didn't pick the first call. Then she called again, and I said, this must be important. Then I picked it up. Then she told me that Pastor actually has some articles that he wants to convert to books, and he's going to pay you $2,000. To me, I thought that was 2,000 grains. Trust me, I didn't believe it until I had a Skype call with Pastor, and Pastor told me specifically. And on that day, I've actually written the synopsis. I submitted it to Pastor already, and Pastor told me that this book is not going to work. You're not a writer at all. So I was like, okay. I insisted that day on the Skype call that, okay, Pastor, please just tell me my mistakes. Because I am willing to learn. I love writing. So it would be a great opportunity to learn, so if you can correct me. So Pastor told me the corrections to make. I thought I got it. I did the second time. I sent it to Pastor. Pastor said, okay, this time around, you look more like a writer, but you're writing like a preacher. You're not writing like a book, like an author. So Pastor rejected the book again. So actually, before the first book was completed, I think Pastor returned almost 7 times before the first book was completed. So I had to correct it every single time. And this was when I met Pastor.
Can you imagine the kind of character the guy has? 7 times. And we are talking about 50,000 words.
Book.
He had to be rewriting everything. 50,000 words. That's a 300 pages book, like this. You know, like this. 300 page book. He has to be writing everything 7 times. Respect. 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 Respect.
So, Pastor, and every time, the truth about it is that every time Pastor corrected it, I always saw my mistake. So, every time Pastor asked me to do something, I go back to the book, check out the book, and see that, okay, this was actually what Pastor was saying. And being able to effect it doesn't mean it's perfect. I still sent it to Pastor. Pastor,
but what I was after was not even book. I was after excellence. I wanted to take him to a place whereby he will begin to think excellence. He will begin to even not permit himself to do anything less than excellence. That he will not even allow himself to do anything below standard. What I was even after was the discipline, the qualities that will come out as a result from him. The discipline, the focus, the determination, the details, the meticulosity. The ability to be meticulous. I knew that if he will pass the exam, if he will make it, he will become one of the top guys in the world. But not just in writing books, in everything else.
So, thank you, sir. So, one of the reasons why I told Pastor that I'm learning and I'm being paid for learning. Unlike when we go to school, we pay the school teaches us. But now, you are learning for free and you are being paid for learning. In school, money leaves your pocket to the school. This time around, you attend class, and because for you to even start at all, the condition is you must watch a minimum of 40 videos
of messages of these messages
of pastor, and you must read a minimum of 2 books. So that being done already, that's an investment on its own. And by that time, I was opportune. That was the time pastor was doing a series on money and joblessness. Like time commerce. So it was really, really helpful for me at that point in time. Even though that was not the topic I was writing on, due to the fact that I had to watch 40 videos, I had to go and pick those ones that pastor has been doing from February 2016 till around May. And I was watching everything. So I was learning. And while writing the book, definitely you have to do some research. Definitely it's going to take your time. Definitely it's going to take sacrifice. I'm in school. I have to combine my schooling with writing the book. So at times it's going to reduce your sleeping time. It's not going to be if you know, like there's this popular saying that if it were to be easy, everybody would do it. So it's not going to be easy. It's going to take a lot of probably, and I tell you that pastor does not give up. If it were to be others, trust me, from the first time I won't be able to contact pastor. But after pastor rejected me multiple times, that was when he even gave me his personal contact. So that I will be able to contact him and he will correct me directly. Because pastor takes time to go through the... If you see the way the corrections are, it's something I feel anybody willing to go through the process who is patient enough can do this thing. Because the corrections are there, you'll be told, this is what you've done wrong. So if you are patient enough to read the corrections, you should be able to do it. And now I'm in school. Of course, we all know that the Ukraine system has made study easy. Let's be honest with ourselves. Compared to other countries, we have a lot of time and we can do a lot of things. I'm studying medicine and I'm becoming a good author before I graduate. I'm proud to say that. And I know that very soon, now, even if I have a project to do on writing, I can probably put that on hold. Because I know by the time I'm done with up to 4, 5, 6 books of pastor, and I release my book, I don't need...
What's that?
Under 1 week, it's going to be a bestseller on Amazon. It's good. It's obvious. Because we can see the testimonies on pastor's books already. So if pastor has to go through the book and approve it in his name, for a book to come out in his name, it probably means probably it must have gotten to a particular standard. At least I know that at the end of the day, where I started. In fact, now I know that where I started is not where I am now. Because at least I can now write a synopsis that pastor will read through once and say, no, I've accepted it. Unlike the first time that I had to write many times. So at least that's an improvement. And the more I write, the easier it becomes. Because the more you do something constantly, like pastor told in one of his videos that there is a rule that if you do something about 10,000 times, you become a genius in it. 10,000 hours. Thank you. 10,000 hours, you become a genius in it. So there was a day I met you. Pastor was like, see, geniuses are not born. They are made. They are made. Geniuses are not born. So you don't have to be born a genius. There are skills you can learn. There are things you can improve on. And because there's no way you write for pastor, you need to... Pastor does not take other... If you want to listen to other preachers or read other books and put them into pastor's books, it won't work. It will reject it. So you have to study his materials to be able to do... You have to study his materials. And through studying those materials, you get to know a lot of things. You get to know a lot of... Like this few days, pastor has been teaching. Pastor has been teaching about money. People pray for money, but
God cannot give us money because God did not create money. He created wealth. It is that wealth we can choose. So money is not something we can pray to God for. Money is only what we can get from the wealth he has given us. And your number one thing is time. Time is the greatest wealth of all. This time he has given us everybody. There's no greener pasture anywhere. Go to US, they have 24 hours. Go to Nigeria, they have 24 hours. Go to Dubai, it's still the same 24 hours. There might be different time zones, but trust me, 24 hours is still the same thing. And this is what people have come. We are young here. But I would like you guys to reflect and see this thing. We all use Facebook today. Mark Zuckerberg started at this age. They all worked. They converted their time to what they are today. So we can start now. We are not too young to start it. We can finish. There was someone who was talking, I think, 2 days ago, who says, I want to finish as a millionaire. I don't know. If you check the present exchange rate, do you know what $2,000 is worth in Naira now? 970,000. If you write 2 books, how much is that? So you can graduate as a millionaire.
Amen. Amen.
By writing. By being patient enough. By putting hard work and by sacrificing. Thank you very much.
Important thing in writing for me is discipline. Working with me at all together, working with me. Either you live in my house, you ask my cousin there, Gideon. When it comes to Libya in summer, even my own son says he thought he was busy in university. But when it comes, anytime he comes back to work with daddy, that is when his busyness starts. That is when he's real. He doesn't know anything like working with daddy. It's like, and when you come here to live, that is when your crisis begins. But even if you are not living with me, but you are, okay, like for example, Caroline, she came here for 2 HMT, but now she has come here to live here for 6 months and she's working with me. Ask her, it's the beginning of her crisis. Because it's work all the time. Demands all the time. So people don't see that other side. But you will see them shining. You will see them later on exploding, talking like this, authority. But there are no, those things will never happen without the process of pain. So, you be able to write a book. Talk about the discipline it takes. How many times do you have to listen? How much time do you have to, how do you combine that with classes? What, is it night? Is it day? Is it, how does that work?
Okay, normally, the timetable almost everywhere in the country is from, you know, no matter the level you are, at least from 8 to 3, 4, you are in classes. So definitely, if the school is in session, most the bunch of the day is gone.
What year are you in?
I'm in 5th class, sir. So the bunch of the day is gone. And at the end of the day, you discover that the only time you have to prepare for class and also be able to write this book, because trust me, before you'll be able to even get all the message from the video. At times, the pastor says it and it looks like a joke. You can't get all the information on the video if you listen to it once. In fact, not 3 times. Not to talk of when you want to write a book on it. So you know how many times you have to listen to this. So at times, this video, you keep it on, you sleep, you wake up on it, the video is still playing. At times, you have to leave the series on. And there was something very profound about this. I usually leave it on like that, just play pastor's messages. One of my Muslim friends, he just overhear some of these things. He started arguing with some of his Christian friends. Do you know that with some of these things this pastor is saying, do you know it's true?
That's a Muslim guy.
That's a Muslim guy that's just.
And who was he telling that?
He was telling a Christian.
And what were the Christians saying?
The Christians were like, this pastor is controversial, he's always attacking churches, he's always attacking other pastors and all that. But he was like, if you listen to it, I think some of these things he's saying, they are actually true.
So it takes a Muslim to come and convince them.
So at times,
at times listening to the video over and over and over again and trying to write them. At times you write them and you don't submit any artwork to pastor. Because you might be surprised that from the introduction alone, if pastor loses a grammatical error from there alone, like, he's coming back. So he's coming back. So it goes through a lot of, you have to read, you have to write it, read over. After listening to the video, you've been able to get the information from the video, you've been able to get all the information you need, you'll be able to make a chapter out of it. You still need to read these chapters over and over again before sending it back. And imagine doing all that. You thought you've done a good job, you send it to pastor, and all the years, you don't think you can do this job. So, and the job will now come back, you still need to edit them and send them back. So that's why I think most people actually run away from things like this. But in the long run, the first one might be difficult. The second one will be easier than the first one. The third one becomes easier. By the time you get into the fourth, the fifth one, it's becoming automatic. But it takes the pain. The price you pay to write the first one is what you enjoy when you start writing the fourth, the fifth one.
But what are the gains you think this is giving you? Because you are now saying, you are telling me in the house that even the money is not even the most important thing now.
Yes,
so what are the things that are the most important?
Okay, personally, this has been able to help me to be able to manage my time well. Like when I resumed in September.
The greatest wealth.
Yeah. When I resumed in September, I knew what I had to do to get what I wanted. So this made me to be able, there are a lot of people I couldn't say no to before. I said no to a lot of people. I said no to a lot of meetings. Now, when I go for a particular meeting, I need to calculate the number of hours. Please, if you are keeping me there for the next 3 hours, I don't want my 3 hours is now what? So I no longer go for... You probably get the names of being antisocial. You probably get the names of being not being able to... But like Pastor said, he has not been able to travel for like 8 years. But within that time, he has been able to produce how many books? So now, he's not able to travel around the world, but the world is coming to meet him. So you might be, most of the people we are running to meet today, like Microsoft in the garage, right? Facebook in a dormitory, right? This like Twitter, Instagram, they came out from these places. The whole world is going to deliver. But those things started where they had to lock themselves up in solitude. Some of these things were developed out of solitude. So these things, this kind of discipline, you will be paid, fine. But what you become, for example now, if I don't write this thing today and I write my own book, I'm very sure the quality of my book will be good. So at the end of the day, I am creating an asset for myself. And I thank God, the pastor is paying me for creating an asset for myself. Because I am becoming better writing this book.
How will you compare the first book you wrote now, in hindsight, with the quality of the one you are now doing?
Honestly, the first one I did, if I'm to do that one again, if I'm going to get that one back, I'm sure me myself, not pastor this time, I'm sure me myself will have corrections on the book. So I'm sure me myself I will have corrections, because at times I still have the book, but okay, since pastor is not talking about it, I just leave that. But at times I know, I did this thing in that book. If I'm to write it now, I wouldn't have done something like that. I wouldn't have written it this way. So sure, I've actually improved. Thank you, sir.
Any questions for Abiola?
Oh my God.
Okay, let's look into the Facebook. Maybe they have questions for you. So you guys on watching on Facebook, if you have questions, let's just write your question here.
name of your books.
Okay.
No, we will not tell you the names yet because they are not yet released. Yes, we are going to release them in future. Favor Geoffrey says, "What a determined young man. I'm learning not to give up from you." Ah, okay. You want to know my books? If you want to know the names of my book, then you have to go to Amazon. Just put my name there, Sunday Adelaja. You'll be able to see all kind of lists of books there. Okay, they're asking you, Abiola, how many hours do you sleep now? Especially when the books are being written.
Most of the time, normally I watch through the night. Basically, I sleep between...
Look here.
Most of the time, normally I wake throughout the night. So when I come back from school, basically I sleep between, let's say, 7 to 11 or 12. 7 p.m. to 11 p.m.
How many hours?
That's 4 to 5 hours. Every day.
4 to 5 hours.
Yes, sir.
Good, good. Okay, now they're asking the question, what gave you the courage, the tenacity to keep on going after being rejected so many times?
Okay, actually, I knew, what actually gave me the courage was because I've always loved writing since when I was young. So this was like an open opportunity for me to polish and refine my skills. They might be there in the raw talent, but it needs to be polished. And I felt this was one of the greatest opportunities because pastor's books goes worldwide. So if I could write a book that pastor will approve, meaning I could go worldwide also. So yeah, this was like a golden opportunity for me to learn and improve my skills. So I just had to take the opportunity. And thank God, pastor was willing to invest in me and train me also.
Wow, someone here by the name, let me see the name again. Somewhere here by the name Mobu Eberendu says, I also want to learn to write, but for free. I want to train with you. I want to write for you for free. Mobu Eberendu. Okay, anybody who wants to write for me, either for free or for money, just write to my email. My email is pastor@godembassy.org. pastor@godembassy.org. If anybody is on there, Pastor Nkiru, maybe you write for them. Pastor Nkiru will write my email for you now. It's pastor@godembassy.org. Or if anybody is there, please write. Yeah? Yes.
Okay.
he has a lot to tell you about that one.
Okay. There's actually probably send you a format that you should follow, so you can probably use that format to guide you. And you probably, if you, you know, one of the conditions before you even start at all, you must have read some of his books. So the books you've read will probably give you the structure that pastor wants to follow in most of his books. And if there's a particular structure you want, he will tell you. So pastor is always open to correct you at any point or at any junction you get to.
And someone is saying, do you read, write, and type at the same time?
Yeah, I do.
Yep. A.K. Godsman say, I want to write too. Yeah, all of you who want to write, somebody will write my email for you now. Somebody will write my email. Yeah. Huh? Yeah, so go ahead. My email is pastor@godembassy.org. Godembassy.org. Because the changes that you get, the changes that take place in your life, and the discipline you develop, They are precious. They are invaluable. They are much more valuable than any kind of money you will receive. Yeah, Obi Ojimadu just wrote my email there. See Obi Ojimadu, then you see pastor@godembassy.org. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you. Bless. So now, while you're in places, I want to hear your feedback on the class we just had.
And that is, what is the topic of the class again? You are going to be rich, or are you going to be rich or poor? You decide. Are you going to be rich or poor? You decide. From where you are, just raise up your hand where you are. What did you get from me? And what do you think you yourself you took from that particular class? Is there anything that ministered to you? Is there anything that you took for yourself or nothing? Absolutely. Anybody wants to talk about the lesson? We just finished. Class we just finished.
Yeah. Well, Pastor, thank you so much for.
If you don't have enough, all of you have to stand up tomorrow. You have to stand and answer.
Yeah, so today I had a discussion with someone of one of the inner conflicts I have, because I was telling Pastor Joshua today that I'm beginning to feel like I'm not sociable, because
Joshua, I call you Sam, but you are Joshua. Why am I calling? Where did I get Sam?
So I was telling him today that for me to have a conversation with someone for 30 minutes, it means that conversation must have value. So it's either I'm adding value to you or you're adding value to me.
Really?
I can't just be laughing with you and we're playing for 30 minutes. So I began to feel like...
Oh, if you have gotten to that place, you have just stepped out of mediocrity into the track field of greatness. That is the beginning of it. When you begin to value time, you are at the threshold. You are starting on the threshold of greatness.
Yeah. So today's teaching, just I was telling that it was a big deal. So we talked about it. I'm like, who can I ask for advice? So I was like, okay, I will speak with Pastor Obi, because first I'm a pastor. I pastor church. So there's a demand on me to spend time with people. There's a demand on me to call your members. How are they doing? Go to their rooms, sit down with them, talk to them, things like that. But
that's to be purposeful.
It has to be purposeful. So that's the difference. But I'm listening to you today. Just give me the courage and everything I need to say, okay, Anu, maintain that principle. It's a value that you've built. Continue to invest your time. And anybody that really desires to spend time with you, it has to have a purpose. It has to be of great value.
Anyone wants to say anything? We have discovered Bella.
One thing that really stood out was when you said poor people are always waiting for the workday to end. I mean, it's something that none of us would really think about on a normal day, because once you're giving work, and especially if the work is tough and strenuous, you know that, oh, you know what, let me just finish. Especially, I mean, let's not lie, we're all students. There are so many of us that you mentioned 8 to maybe 3 o'clock. As medical students, once it's getting to 2:30, you start, I don't know, your vibe changes, your mood changes compared to when you first got there, or maybe the middle of the day. When it's getting towards the end, unconsciously we just start to, oh, you know, in fact, let me confess something. When it's getting to the end of the day, sometimes I'm already thinking about the lunch I'm going to eat when I go home, especially if I've been in class and the class is tough. So one thing I've learned now is that the work never stops. If I actually want to step out of mediocrity, the work never stops. On the way back to the hostel, I should be thinking, when I get there, I should also be thinking, during my time of rest, whatever I'm doing, I feel like now I've realized that work never should stop, actually. And not just thinking, but acting in line with what I'm thinking about.
And that is the whole idea of HMT. HMT is not just some 4 days of wonders. When you control yourself, you control your time, barely survive it, and then you survive it. Now I can live anywhere. I thank God I escaped and I survived. The idea of HMT is for you to be able to learn to live this lifestyle. This is the way, in this house, this is the way we live every day. This regime. So even when we're eating, we're reading something. Even when we're, you know, my son came here and said it the other day. Anything you are doing, you are always busy. You are always working. But it's not work anymore. It's development. It's adding value. It's wealth. It's exploration.
Good evening, everybody. Good evening. I'm really thankful. What I've learned today is to value my time. Most importantly, time. You know, I attended the last History Makers Training, the one in January. But it was more, I would say it was, we relaxed. Because there was a day we'll finish and then there won't be any assignment. Then we were very happy, but...
you are rejoicing when there was no work.
Yeah, but then...
really, that's not helping you.
Yeah, I came to realize that I could manage... I sleep at 4 and wake up at 7:30.
3 hours.
Yeah, and it will be enough. So I think it really made me to really think and about how my to manage my time. And the other thing is, there's Pastor Sunny. Where's Pastor Sunny? He's gone. He's somebody who, he's time conscious. If we say we start service at 10 we start. We finish at 12 we finish. You know, he made me really realize that you really have to be cautious about your time and what you do with your time. And then when we're talking about critical thinkers and how poor people are not critical thinkers and how rich people are critical thinkers, somebody on Facebook, Laura Edokobi Ikelbi. Hi, Laura. She said something about most rich people don't think much again because they feel they have reached a certain age where their workers are the brain thinkers for them and they only supervise at that stage. My question is that wrong?
They have, it's only the nature of work changes.
Yeah.
It's not that they stop working. Because when they stop working, they start losing. And when they don't, they are, the work of supervision is even more difficult than doing the work yourself. That is what the person doesn't know. Because when you try to supervise people and they are doing it wrong, and you feel like crying, and you feel like even going to do it yourself. So the supervision work is other people who don't know what it is that think you are enjoying. But when you are supervising and you have to look and for make people to do it, they never do right. And that is when real suffering comes. So that is another set of skills that you need. So when they say they don't work, that is even a more difficult work than the work to do the work itself.
Thank you. Lara, I think I hope your question or your comment is answered.
Thank you so much, sir. From yesterday till today, I think today is a continuation of the bomb you released yesterday. And it's even more ballistic today. So for me, it confirms to me that the path I'm treading is the right one, and I just need to intensify what I'm doing. But I have a question, and this comes from the dichotomy of choice.
What?
Dichotomy.
What is that?
So, as an entrepreneur, you are taught that no money is too small, but on placing value on time, I've always found it that, because I have so many startups that if, by God's grace, what I've learned now, if I should go back to Nigeria or anywhere I find myself and I'm actually done with school, at least I can empower people with them, even if I will not be the one directly responsible. And I keep learning more skills so that by the time I show them I can do it, then they can believe that I'm actually helping them, really. But in the place of even making it a business here, especially when I transferred to Lviv, let me use photography for an example. They want to pay you, and there was a boy who was doing it for petty money. And so they want to bring that to you too. So because I won't take it, obviously they go to that guy. So, but my own principle was, I cannot work 1 hour, for example, for $10. Because I'm looking at the investment I will make in my mind, and I spend, sometimes I just lie on my bed for 3 hours, meditating, thinking, and bringing so many pictures and scenarios. So I think that's why I can hardly go to a meeting without knowing the various ways in which discussions can go. So they think I always have answer to everything. And sometimes that is even dangerous. But I'm always there thinking, so I'm looking at the amount of that 1 hour, $10 is too small for me for my 1 hour. So I don't think I can, because of entrepreneurship, go and spend 1 hour. I would rather do it for free. So how does one balance probably the principle of no money is too small and the principle of valuing, putting a value on your time and not working for anything less, or doing something for anything lesser than that.
That's a lot of process and a lot of stages, as what you have described. If you listen to my message, why I don't drive and my wife doesn't cook, that come kind of illustrate what the dilemma that you are explaining now. And I'm not sure you listen to that message.
Well, probably I need to go back and listen to it again.
Yes. Okay. So in that message, I'm saying why my wife doesn't cook. I mean, why my wife is not a housewife that's just cooking. And why she doesn't cook. She can cook, of course, we know that. But, you know, the idea is that instead of wasting that time on cooking and standing in the kitchen, that we would rather pay somebody else or a whole team of staff people who will do that. And she could use her time to do something much more valuable. If this thing she is doing is converted to money, it will be costing, in that same one day of standing in the kitchen, she might be creating a wealth of at least $1,000, whereby in the month, you only need to pay that $1,000 for a whole month, for a woman who work a whole month to cook. So why don't you just use the value of one day to pay for a whole month and buy yourself back your whole month, rather than wasting a whole month just, you know, cooking what other person can do. So any other thing that any other person can do for a man that has added value to himself and for a man that knows how to explore wealth, I would rather pay money, give away money, so that I'll be able to save myself time that I will use to build wealth. So, but there is a stage for everything. That, what I've just said now, is when you are already on the starting stage, when surviving is not your question, when you are no more thinking about what to eat or what to drink, when you already have the minimum that you need to get by, then you might neglect altogether that kind of $10 or small money. But when you are still building and you are not yet in that place where you have excessive or excess cash flow, you might want to just close your eyes and still sacrifice to go and make that $10 just because you need it, so you need cash flow. So, you know that it's for a season. And then you find a better time to compensate, to gain that back, to add to that value that was lost when you are making that small money. I don't know if you got that. Yes.
To make it answer to Victor. It's like what Pastor is saying, that at the beginning, if that $10 is the difference between you being hungry and having food, you know, like it's for survival, then you have to go for it.
Yes.
Then when you now have enough money I have for the month, now you believe that you have to step up, then you can start saying, oh, it's no more $10, it's $15. Mm-hmm. But it's better when you repackage that particular service that you are giving.
Exactly.
You have to be different now. Give something different from the other photographer. Repackage, make it better so that when somebody comes to you and says, oh, this photographer takes $10 and you are asking for $20, they have to see why you are asking for $20. Because you've repackaged, you've made it innovative and it is different. You have now gone to the next level. You are now better. And now you can sell your services. Thirdly, that means you must now have a price tag for every hour, for your every hour. So if anybody comes with anything low, you show him your price list, the person will say, thank you, I'll think about it. They will go themselves. Those who know the value of what you are giving, they will pay. They will call you. They will be telling others, please, Victor is the guy. That's what I see.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much, sir. I actually never knew I had equal opportunities of getting riches and equal opportunities of developing myself as everyone. Because I always think,
on the planet, yes.
Yeah, I actually always think, like people that actually make it or people that actually get riches are people that, like, they surround themselves with people that have it. You see, they influence, you understand, they have connections. I always think that for me, I can actually do more than I have. I can't do more. I can't be successful more than the people I surround myself with. Like I can't do more than I have. I can't go outside my beyond. Like if my father is this wealthy, I can be more wealthy, but just a little. I can't go far. You understand? So, but now I have gotten the understanding that what I need to do is that to become people like people that I admire is to use my time, my resources, and I should put hard work into it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Pastor, tonight again. Actually, today's topic, I wouldn't say this is my first time because Pastor wrote a book on Time is Life. And if we should read that book very well, it talks more about time. And that was something that became part of me, which is time being a resource. And that thing is the fact that during my holidays, anytime I come to Pastor's place, that is a way it trains us or people that will be around, that you just have to know the value of the time. So even if we are spending 12 hours or 6 hours at a stretch, believe you me, after like 2 weeks or 3 weeks of that thing, when you leave his environment, even if you don't read any book, even if you don't know, it becomes part of you. You will know what your time is. Because I discovered that when I go back to my city, there is a popular place that we normally go for recreation, for fun. So I now notice that for more than a year, I never stepped into that place because I didn't just know. And when my friend asked me, something has happened. Even there was a time a particular company left that building and I didn't know because I was not, because I don't go to that because I never saw a reason why I should go. I now remember the only time I went there was because I had a purpose. I wanted to get something. And after getting that thing, I left. Also, there was something that happened in class. There is a groupmate of mine. I noticed that he knows more things than me. And there was a particular that I was not happy with him because each time they threw a question to us, they would just talk. So that day I took it kind of personal. So I listened to Pastor's message that day. I listened to Pastor's message when I got home. And Pastor spoke about time, something related to time. And he said that, you know what, the reason why some people get some results you're not getting is because of what they do with their time. So I just applied that thing to what happened in the afternoon. I was like, maybe this guy is spending his time on spending more time on that particular course, the course we're having that time. So I now, to the next day, I now asked him that, there was something that just happened. I now said that, this guy even spent more time, and he has he registered to a website that he reads more on different topics. So I said, this is what you do. Okay, so next time when things happen, when you get this result, I don't need to be angry. All I just need to do is just to work more and also do more than what he's doing. So
which is the confirmation of this principle I gave you yesterday, that anything you have or you don't have, anything you have is because you have paid the currency of time for it. But the things that you don't have is because you have not paid the currency of time. That's why you still don't have that thing. Time is the currency with which everything is bought. And time is the material from which everything is made.
Okay, sir, there's this question I just want to ask you, sir. If it's wise to do, when placing value on my time now, if I see that the little time I have, if I see something that could give me more value, and I see I have another option that could make me spend time, but lesser value to me, or lesser value or lesser things to add to me, which option should I? Should I, because of my interest of spending my time on one part, And I have another part also, which is part B, that could add more value to my time or give me more results than me giving out more of my time for my interest. So now, giving time to my interest...
It's too complicated. Yeah. I don't understand again.
Okay, what I'm saying is that...
You have to say in one sentence, in one statement. If you cannot say it in one statement, then you have to sit down, think it through, and the shorter you can say it, that is the better.
Okay, what I'm saying is that giving my time to my interest and giving my time to what will give me more value, what will add to the value of my time, which one should I go for?
I still don't understand. Anybody understand?
Time constraints that giving is time, to something or allowing something to invest in its time so that time, instead of just going out and using it, he's doing something in that time.
I still don't understand.
Yeah, sorry, can I ask? Your interest, is it your hobby? Is it a relationship? Is it your desire?
Yeah, it's a desire.
It's a desire. Okay. Pastor, his question is that, can he give his time? Can he give his time to his desires at the expense of adding value to himself?
What desire? Is the desire adding value to?
Yes.
But not as much as.
What do you mean desire?
Like my passion, like my potential. Okay. The example is this, that okay, I have a desire now to go for the president of my association in Telugu, and I also have my time to buy now. I want to invest my time. Rather than going for that, I also want to invest this same time that I have into something that I know I will get to results from.
Okay. First of all, you are talking about short-term and long-term interest.
Yes.
Okay. And short-term and long-term value. So the question is about, is my short-term value, added value, worth it for the expense of the long-term value? So being the president of your country or your association, that is a long-term value. It might be sacrificed now because you are going to be sacrificing. You are going to be serving. You are going to be sacrificing your time. You are going to be ministering to people. But you are developing other skills that will give you long-term value. You are developing people relational skills. You are developing stewardship. You are developing service. You are developing love. You are developing leadership skills. You are developing influence. So those things will come back to you. But they are just the long-term value that will be added. But what you now want to ask is that the short-term value that could give you immediate result now, can you do without it? Can you survive without that immediate particular value? If you can, then it's always good to go for the long term.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Stanley. So, there's something Pastor Sunday said that kind of messed me off because it went against my belief system. Because normally you believe that the reason for being poor is laziness. But there's something that Pastor Sunday said that made me start thinking, for somebody to be poor, it does not necessarily mean that the person is lazy. Because there are some people that really work hard, but all they do is they work hard at work. For their jobs. And all their thinking capacity, everything, they use all their strength for their job. And this is just like we said in the morning, this is just a place where you get money and not a source of wealth. So, I won't lie, I think I'm a little bit guilty of this. Because I spend much of my time doing,
duties.
And I spend very little of my time trying to create wealth.
for myself. So I think this is even the major challenge in my country, Nigeria. Everybody is out on the streets hustling. Yeah. Everybody's hustling. Everybody wants, you know.
That's what I said, that people have wealth, but they are neglecting wealth. They don't even have time to think about wealth because they are busy looking for money. They don't know that money is so much inferior to wealth. And they don't have, because money is immediate. And wealth also is immediate, but it is so huge. It is transgenerational. So people who want immediate satisfaction, instant gratification, they only focus on money. Whereby they actually are in the midst of wealth. But they just need to have patience, concentration, focus, and conversion of wealth. If they could spend more of those things I said that the rich people do to convert those wealth. And why are you people always paying attention to only our time? Time is just number one of the wealth. I mentioned four other wealth, sources of wealth there that also must be equally converted. Wealth doesn't come only from time. It comes from all of the five that I mentioned earlier.
Okay, so what I'm saying in essence is, I know many of us, we work hard, understand? But the point is, try to work hard, try to focus your hard work in a place of more importance and not a place that probably will grant you an instant gratification. Thank you.
Everyone. My name is Dennis.
Frank has a bias for men.
Today I learned.
I have a bias for women. And I think every real man must have bias for women. Yeah. So give up first.
Thank you, sir. Okay. I learned that a rich person is a thinker, and the way I more of like classified it was that a rich person is equivalent, like the rich person always think deeply, why a poor person just overthinks. Person just like there's no
things they think about. They think about their problems,
yes,
and what is going on. And they think about other people and talk about other people. That's it. So it's not, we are not inventing what they are thinking about. It is known. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, and another thing I also learned from the teaching was that, it's so funny. The rich people, they believe in faith, but they believe more in hard work. And through that hard work, it's more of like they've discovered the wealth and they're using that wealth to create riches, to create money.
Beautiful.
And it's, hard work is, wow.
It's an instrument that you use to convert. Hard work is the only tool and the best tool of conversion. Is the element, is the basic tool of conversion of every kind of wealth to riches, and from riches to money. Only hard work. Only work.
Yeah, and
hard work has varieties. Work has varieties. Varieties of hard, I mean, work is hard work, diligence, excellence, quality, and, you know, different kind of creativity. All those things are designing. All those things are just varieties of work.
Yeah, and hard work is not easy. Hard work comes with pain. Hard work comes with practice. Hard work comes with so many sleepless nights. I do this. But that there was an example of that. And now it's actually earning from it. Hard work, yeah, hard work is actually, it's not easy, it's difficult. Hard work is pain, yeah, okay, But
is that the reason why our people are looking for miracles more?
Yes.
Good evening once again. I came to understand the meaning of one verse in Proverbs. It says that the rich and the poor have one thing in common. The Lord made them all. And I used to think, oh yeah, the Lord made the poor, he made the rich, well, he made them. But then I've somehow gotten the essence of what that scripture really means, is that the Lord made them all equal. With equal resources.
So the way people, you mean that the way you used to think before was that God made this one rich and made that one poor? Yeah. No, are you sir? Yeah. That's what you used to think.
That's what you had thought.
That's what you had thought. Yeah. And now, then it means you are talking of destiny then. No, your destiny is in your hand, though. It's not in God's hand, though. God gave everybody equal treatment. Everyone is equal, the same. Everybody is rich, the same. Everybody on earth, though, has equal rich and wealth and richness. Everybody is already rich equally. So God didn't put one to be rich, and say that's destiny, and this one to be poor, and say, okay, well, that is destiny, or what is it, faith? That is faith. You cannot account that, yes? There's nothing you can do about it. That is faith. God has decided it. So if that is the case, then nobody should struggle. Nobody should work hard. Nobody should even attempt to change. Why should you try to change the faith then? Or the destiny, if that's what God has already decided. If God has already decided that you are the one he created poor, why are you then struggling?
Oh my
God. Huh? You get it? So that is not his case. He created everybody with equal opportunities. Only we don't know. Or we've been taught wrong. Yeah. But maybe we could change the world by it. Thank God that you mentioned that, because that is helping a lot of, you are not alone in that. Yeah. You are not alone in that thought. You see, you have a lot of colleagues around. Let him talk.
Oh no, I'm finished.
And the sister there, who first born is that?
Okay, I've gleaned a wealth of mind-changing information from this article, or from this teaching. And you guys will permit me to just share them real quick.
Don't clap. Yeah, you've been silent all through the ancient
thing. I didn't know you
were. So it's your time now.
Okay, so the first reflection is based on what you said about rich people that continuously, on a constant basis, they add value to themselves. And it's what just popped into my mind was Pastor Louia. He, like 2-3 weeks ago, he gave me a topic to build an article.
His name was Pastor Louis. You said Pastor Louis, yeah?
Okay, then Pastor Louis.
Okay.
A couple of weeks ago, he gave me an article to write. And like over the past 1 year, I decided to create a blog. And over the years, though, I've been accumulating some writing and stuff. And Pastor Louis has been encouraging me to like just push myself out there, And I've been very reluctant about it. So he gave me an article. And I was really pissed that he gave me that article, because I realized that I had to spend time, I had to do research, I had to read the Bible. There are so many things that I had to do if I wanted to write the article and write it well. Until now, I'm putting myself in trouble by like putting myself out there right now. But till now, I haven't finished writing the article, and I've been postponing it. So that is one thing that has challenged me here. And then you mentioned space, the source of wealth, space. And that rich people, their space is books. It's materials that edify them. And I realized that over the holiday, in fact, I think we had like 3 weeks before we had to come here, after we were released from school for the vacation. And I had plans. I was going to read, I was going to study, I was going to work out, eat right, and all those things. And I realized that, now, this is me being honest, up to seven hours out of my day, each day for 3 days, I spent it watching movies. Watching a series, I was watching back to back of the same series. And when you accumulate that time, you realize that I could have finished Pastor Lewis's article and done so many other things. And it wasn't. And then you also said there is no regimen per se for rich men; they work in and out of season. My plan was to rest during the holiday. And going forward now, in fact, as you were telling me this, or you were telling us this, I just started building a structure of things that I have to do before next week, because I guess we're resuming next week. And the third one is, while poor people are afraid of doing things and taking steps, the rich are busy taking risks. And what occurred to me was that for a long time, in fact, I think it was a year ago, there were some things that just went really haywire in my life. And I started pouring out the emotions that I had pent up. I started pouring them out in writing and just putting it, just really, I have so much, I have like 100 and something things that I wrote here on my iPad over the past 1 year. But I have
articles or poems?
Poems, just me musing and just ruminating and just putting stuff out there. And it's like maybe one person or two people that have actually seen it. And they're like, why don't you put your stuff out there? But the thing about me is that I'm very, concerned, private, and then concerned about criticism. Yeah. Criticism.
Well, you could use pseudonyms. You could use pseudonyms.
Okay. So I'm very concerned about criticism and what people might, you know, think about the thoughts that are going through my head, because usually they are kind of weird, and I feel like I'm kind of weird sometimes. So I was just accumulating them.
That, you know, one of the things we spoke about in the morning, were the things that make other people think that you are weird. That is your own resource.
So I created the blog, even though I haven't been like consistently releasing material, but I created the blog and I started to push myself out there. But another thing I noticed, even though I have the blog, when I actually post things up there, I just share them within my circle. So I'm sharing them on my Instagram, and I have like maybe 300 and something followers. I share them on my Snapchat. I have maybe top 40 people that are following me. I share them on my WhatsApp group pages, and that's just maybe in all, let's just say, maximum of 40 people. So really, I'm not putting, and these are people that know me. So of course, they won't tell you what you're writing is nonsense, or you need to. So this is just really challenging me to just push myself out there, just put myself out there, regardless of what I feel that people will think. And the funny thing is, like, I don't know if they are trying to like wind me or anything, but the response I've gotten so far has been really encouraging. So thank you, sir, for the message once again.
To confirm the fact that you are really willed, you are willed, yeah? That weird, the fact that you are weird is the fact that, do you all people notice how she responded? In the morning, I was very concerned at the way we were responding, because we were giving answers non-relating, not applicable, not applying the knowledge to practical life situations. But she is the one who has given the best answer. So that confirms your awareness. That confirms your awareness. So do you now see that you are off, you are willed, and you are this? That's what made you to do better than everybody else.
I actually just wanted to say
say the fault of how, especially how now most African Christian think it's not really on them. It's how like the church. I myself also guilty. Teach people to do, cause you find prayers, people praying, and they, what they are telling you is that pray when while you are praying, desire something, and like this, you don't pray without desiring, and you must if you don't desire it, it won't happen. Such kind of prayers.
Selfishness.
Yeah.
So prayers is not about relationship with God anymore, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's about desires. It's about me. It's about egocentrism. Whereby it's supposed to just be loving on your father. Just loving on your father. Just enjoying the trip.
And if you don't desire it, it won't happen. So now people are just living by desiring so that it can happen. You know? They dreaming and everything. That's how many people are living.
Yeah, please go. Pastor Louis. Good evening, everyone. My name is Pastor Louis, actually. Yeah, Pastor, thank you so much for this teaching this evening. I've really learned a lot. And I just want to share what I got from this teaching. I've realized that you made a statement and you said every individual on earth actually has equal wealth. But what makes the difference between others being rich and others being poor? Just like the topic says, you can be rich, you can be poor, you can win or you can lose. You decide. It still takes us back to decision. I noticed that whoever we are today, wherever we are today, and whatever we have now is a function of the decision we made yesterday or the decision we failed to make. For instance, if the 5 you had in class yesterday is as a result of a decision you made to read so as to obtain the 5, and the 3 you got was as a result of the decision you made not to get a 5, and that is the result. Now, just like my brother Denny said over there, and which is actually something that has been like a mirage in the church, where we still have Christians who believe that God made them to be poor, and they have to remain poor. But I noticed that in the parable of the talents, the one who did not get much was not because he was not given the talent, but it was because he failed to take he took a decision not to put his talent so that it could bring in more income. And as a result of the wrong decision he made, what God gave him, he had to take it and he gave it all back to the other person who chose or who took the decision to invest his. Likewise, the life of Daniel, why he was excellent, it was because he chose not to have what we call fun, while the others were partaking, they made a decision to enjoy the meal of the king. He took a decision to seek the face of God, develop himself, and he became excellent. So whoever we are in life is a function of what or the kind of decision we take. This also takes me back to what Pastor Bosse said the other day. And in relation to the statement you made, you said, while rich people are busy investing in themselves, trying to upgrade themselves, taking risk, the poor ones are there gossiping and blaming people. She made a very important statement. She said, in as much as in your life you still have one person to blame, then you are irresponsible.
Yes.
And this just opened up my eyes to the fact that we have to learn to decide what we want to be in life. And lastly, I have realized this. Brother Adiola here said something. He said, when you decide to start investing in yourself, some will call you antisocial. It's not once, yeah, really. It's not once, it's not twice I've been called that. I have friends who just deliberately walked away from me because they think I'm boring or I don't give them the time to sit and talk. What are we talking about if it's not going to impact me or impact you? What are we talking about if we cannot, out of the conversation, get something positive that can influence or impact another life out there? Then it's useless. Someone said, don't just gravitate towards a coffee machine to participate in a gossip because that's the only game in town. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor. I had a clarifying question because as you were going through all these points, I started to realize that when you originally were talking about wealth and the five areas of wealth, I thought that it was time or space or you or work or law and order. But now I'm realizing that the height or the fullness of the working of wealth is how these things work together. So like using your time to discover your space and add value to you, and then using work to convert what you've discovered into money that can be protected inside of a law and order system, and that can be generating money for you while, even if you're not working and even after you're dead.
Well, I'm so grateful that you did that, because sometimes when we are teaching, we assume that some things are self-explanatory. So, for example, I didn't even think that it would ever cross the mind of anybody to think they are all or all. I thought it's just self-explanatory that it intertwines into each other, that there are five in total. But I'm just explaining them separately so that you'll be clear with one before we go to the other one. But separate, so that you have them separate in your mind, but you know that they're all interwoven and interwork together. But the way you have said it is so clear, and if you don't mind, I will ask you to say it again.
So from what I understand, you use your time to invest in yourself and discover your space for the gifts that you've discovered inside yourself. And you use the work to convert what you've discovered and what you've put into yourself, that value, into money. And that money is protected and regenerated for generations after generations through the law and order that you, the system of law and order that you put around it.
Thank you. Okay. Joshua.
Yeah, hello everyone. Good evening. My name is Joshua. Pastor, thank you very much for that message. And I want to share this personally. It's a personal experience. And I just want everybody to learn from this. 2015, June, I was here for HMT. And Pastor assigned a book to me. I'll keep the theme of that book, but Pastor knows the theme of that book. And then I...
But not just to you, there were about 15 other people like
that. Yes.
Later, no, eventually.
Eventually, yes.
Initially, five, right? Or
no,
three. Three people?
Yeah.
Yeah, but all this time, I've had about 20 like that, so don't worry. It's not a big thing. Your thoughts for sharing.
Yeah. So... initially, I felt I was occupied and I was doing some things, but at last I turned my attention to that book and I read the article over and over again. So when I finally got into writing that book, I saw that writing that book for the first time in my life was a time I felt alive. And that leads me to say that work is the evidence of life. Because every other activity in my life was built around writing that book. The book gave peace to every other thing I was doing. And then finally, when I finished the book, Of course, I know I submitted the book, sir, but and I already know the book will be rejected, actually. So, yeah. I'm just waiting for the official rejection.
No, but I didn't get it, though. Who did you submit it to?
No, I just submitted it this last week.
So send it to my mail?
Yes, to your mail.
Okay, yeah, I'm not seeing it though.
Yeah, wow, maybe I'll send it to again.
Yes, maybe. Pastor at whatever.
No, I sent it to the one pastor sufficient gave me Olorunwa 67 and June.
Okay. But send it to
Pastor Agode
Masiba. Yes, and send it to that Olorunwa too. So,
okay.
Because I've not seen it yet.
So when I finished the book and I kind of got caught up with other things, then I felt that slowly within me I could feel something dying. And I could feel like slowly within me something was degenerating. Because clearly, work that is the evidence of my life was now missing.
That's so profound. It's so true what they say. You can't believe it. It's so true what they say. It's not just in writing books, but in being addicted to work. When you get addicted to work, that's why, you know, now what he has said now explains why successful people don't pay attention to the house they have, to the houses they have. They know it. They have people managing it, like the other lady said, for them. They have the record. They use the lots of money. But that is not the thing that's giving them joy anymore. They don't know the number of cars they have. That is not, they don't even. Like me, like I said, I don't even remember that I have a house. Talk less of how nice it looks or something. What is giving me life and fulfillment is the addiction to conversion process. To work, to labor. When you are addicted to, when you have discovered the beauty of converting wealth and, you know, of adding value, of conversion, that one becomes your source of life. But so when you buy car or Mercedes or house, you know, those are just like you bought socks or, you know, or underwear. Those are just things you need. They might be nice, they might be, you know, colorful or something, but they are not the thing that give you joy. So keep on saying those things, because those things are very deep, what you are saying now. Because he's talking about an example of someone who has discovered the beauty of labor, the beauty of labor, and the satisfaction of work. And then he left it and got distracted with other things. He's going back to mystery. He's going back to mystery. He's no, not mystery, but misery. He's going back to mystery. And that way, you are going back to suffering. You are going back to emptiness. Beautiful.
And only me could tell, but I knew my life was entering into a state of entropy.
That's it. Because you have tasted higher satisfaction. Now you are going to be living a mundane life. That is real entropy. Beautiful.
And because of that, when I picked up the book again to edit it, I started feeling trickles of life within me again. And that brings me to the story of Adam. That the only evidence that Adam was alive was because God gave him something to do. And this is what many of us, especially as youths, we try to avoid work as much as possible. But according to Pastor's teaching tonight, no man can ever get to the peak of his life without work. And no man will ever discover the best of himself without getting addicted to work. Because God has designed work as the only tool capable of bringing out the best in any man. And any man that refuses to work as hard as possible will only sooner or later enter into a state of entropy, and then it becomes a living dead, and then it becomes a walking dead. I was speaking with Pastor Tammy when we got here, and an idea dropped in my mind. I said, why do we cry when we are born, but remain silent when we die? It is because a crying child knows that the world is a world of work. And he has every reason to raise his voice and begin to walk with his voice, with his legs, with his hands moving, and with everything. But a dead man remains silent because there is no more work to be done. That is why the Bible says, remember your Creator while you are young, while the evil days have not come. Because there is no devising, nothing that can be done in the grave. So, my fellow people, I want to call on us tonight. The devil will waste anybody that will not walk. The escape of any man from misery is walk. The escape of any man from tragedy is walk. The escape of any man from a life of waste and sorrow is walk. Because people that walk barely have time for depression. So, Pastor, thank you very much for tonight's teaching, and I've learned my lesson, and I know I cannot share everything I've learned because there is just so much to be learned from you, sir, and you are a life institution yourself. You are an institution. You are an institution. And there's only one secret that I've found. It's because of work in every ramification. Thank you very much, sir.
Great. Great. Now, let me tell you a secret. For you to be able to get your work done in an acceptable way, so that I will accept it, make sure that you learn, you study this one. Look at the way illustrations are used here. Illustrations. And look at the way intro and outro are done. And especially illustrations. You have this book? Okay, if you don't have, let's give him a copy. Give him a copy right now. Yeah. Then this one, only God can save Nigeria, holds the spirit and the fire. Do you have it? You don't have it. Give him one. So before you send me again, the one you make sure you do a thorough job at examining and studying those two books. The spirit and the fire here. The urgency. The urgency. The spirit and the fire. And here, the methodology.
Thank you so much, Pastor.
Pastor, sir, one more. I just have a question before you go, and I'm asking you this question out of curiosity. And what is that question? Do you ever think anyone in our generation is capable of getting to your depth as a person?
Oh, capable, sure, but I've not met one, unfortunately. I've not met any right now. I've not met. There may be there, maybe even deeper, but I've not met. I've met people who might be deeper in one subject or one area or one other place, but all encompassingly, you know, to have everything in one spot. Like God has given me the grace. Maybe there is, you know. God, you know, you never say never, because God always said there are always 7,000. But I don't know if there is any human being that will have all the deposit and the reservoir of all kind of wisdom from every topic. I mean, like I said, I have 1,000 topics in my head. I mean, already. No, manuscripts. No, books, and 5,000 topics that I've not even had other people talk about. If that are my notes,
And all of them are revolutionary, each one. But that took me 15 years non-stop. Can you imagine, for 15 years, non-stop. I'm doing it up to now. But what I'm doing now is already in a more relaxed form than what I used to do before. You know, but for 15 years, I will go away every month for 7 days, for a week. I will not, you drink only water. And stay in the presence of God, not just praying, studying, hearing, reading, for 14 hours minimum, 14 to 18 hours every day, for 7 days, out of the 4 weeks we have in a month. 1 week will always go to that. No wife, no children, no church, no work, no human being. I don't set these eyes to see any human being. And this voice only talks to my wife and God. For that old, in a year you have 12 months. So then 1 year, 2 years, 15 straight years without one single break. Then when this all lawsuit started, my life became destabilized, unpredictable, because I want to go to retreat now, they say I have to go to court, or I have to go to police, so it just messed me up. So I couldn't really get myself together to really manage it like I used to. I still do it, but not like I used to really do it. The first 15 was like crazy. But in those 15 years, I was able to write 5,000 messages that I never had from human beings, but from heaven. And from studying and pushing myself and adding value and converting. So people might be able to do it, but they will just have to pay the price. But then, in my own case, people pray like that. But I don't just pray. I study. I convert. I add value. You understand? So, and I study widely. Everywhere. Every imaginable and unimaginable things. Yes. In fact, when they were, spreading some rumors about me. Gideon was saying, the reason I know that the thing is not true is because I've lived in pastor's house for months and I see his schedule. Because the way pastor lives his schedule, doesn't just have time. And this is my schedule that you are living in these 4 days. So I work as well. So I do everything work quality. Are nice, because when I'm working with God, like solitude is thorough and is fundamental, is hard work. Then when I'm not in solitude, I'm working also hard. When I'm studying, I don't even regard that I've studied any topic if I've not spent at least 3 weeks studying it. And that's like 3 to 6 hours a day. Then I don't think I've studied it. Yeah, so.
Yes, I just wanted to ask your indulgence to, there was this note I went back to, it's from 4 years ago. Okay. And looking at it now.
A note?
Yeah, it's a poem.
Okay.
Yeah, so I would love to do it in dedicating that to you.
You want to read it now?
Maybe tomorrow. It doesn't have to be now.
Okay, but somebody also wants to do a presentation, one kind of presentation. So video presentation. So you could do your own also now if you want.
Okay.
Can you come here then?
All right.
Thank you. Going through it, I just went back. It's like going back in time, and you see something
maybe
like
4 years ago.
4 years ago. So it's not even something I can remember of it.
I'll
read it. Yeah. So it was titled "Reconciling the Odds," which is what you are doing, and that's why I think the least I can do is to dedicate this to you. So it starts what a weight. Making my thoughts late.
Just lower so that I can process.
Yay, what a weight. making my thoughts late. Arbitrary resignation to fate, waking the unconscious fate. Burial of the minds in the yards of pain. Narrowing the wide ideas, mirroring the greatest fears. Mentoring the bravest cares. The growing feelings maimed and the bravest emotions tamed, producing the incompatible pair. Happening beyond wish, cravings beyond hush. Carnality and absurdity takes on humility. The echoes of a soundless noise, the resonance of an unheard cry. The reality of an approved betrayal, mutiny against a compromised royal. How do we initiate the retrieval? I think you are doing that now. Who will sponsor the revival? Considering the miracle of the parallel, the lines can meet just with a little shift. If we can bury the rift, then our course we can lift. A kingdom divided against itself, though with prior intuition, will fall regardless of ammunitions. But before the odds fall away, we can make them even. Bringing back the glorious array and get back to our Eden. But first we must reconcile the odds. So going back through this, I think... So going back through this, I think I can say you are reconciling the odds and you are sponsoring the revival that our time needs right now, because the mutiny against the compromised royal is taking us. It represents we who are, we've lost our place as humans, and we are chasing after things that should naturally be coming after us if we're actually following the order of creation, like Pastor Joshua rightly pointed out, stressing on the fact that you have talked about how work is very important. And the stress you made was on work, not job. And a lot of people are chasing job, not work. And that's why they are not happy doing something that they are doing, and they think it's work. Because when it's work, passion should naturally flow through it. One understands why. And I think in every ramification of it, finance, relationship, everything, I get to listen to you stress again. I mean, there's only, Pastor knows, before I listened to you, there was only one other preacher I used to listen to, and that is Bishop Noah Jones. I know him also for his depth, but I think you communicate it better in my language. He is Jamaican. So you communicate it better in my language and in let me use the word, my ancestral DNA. So I think that's tautology, right? So if you permit me to use it that way. So I'm able to get it even more. I'm able to relate. I think the first time I had to meet you, it was under the cave there, and that was the first article I read, and that was the reason for nations, and going through it, I said, because of how I reason, I could vibrate, maybe not up to that frequency, but at least as the words were vibrating, I could vibrate with it too. So thank you so much for this deposit, and the truth is, and I want to ask everybody here, don't be under the pressure of this atmosphere. There's a pressure this atmosphere puts on. But the good thing is, and I think seeing my brother, I know you're always doing that. It makes me know I'm not weird.
What does it do?
Yeah, because we go back and try to question again what we've learned.
Yes.
And so going back now, we still spend like another 3 weeks playing the messages over and over again. So please go back home. Don't just be under this atmosphere. Under this atmosphere, you know, one will cool. Yeah, you are charged. You may also want to say nice things to impress pastor. You know, they are good, but at the end of the results, we bring about, I mean, it's about results.
And the only thing that will remain with you, the ones you had now, they are just information, but they will become your own, depending on how much you spend on them by yourself. It is how much you spend reminiscing over them, reminiscing over them, and walking over them, going over and over again, either on your own or with people. It is that one that becomes your own, not the ones you are hearing in the class. So it's very right.
So for me, I am tired of the parallel line. I want my lines to meet. And so that's why I still have another question to ask him, though privately. I hope we have that time soonest. I mean, to ask personally. So it means for every time I listen to him, I'm trying to...
Anybody who wants to meet me personally, make sure you tell Igor to...
We'll meet him after that. So it makes me, every time I listen, it makes me go back to question the fundamentals of, it's called the existential crisis. So, I go through it very well. So it means that's what tells me that the message is actually penetrating, because it's re-engineering, amen, and not just thoughts, but the whole process of life. So thank you so much for helping me reconcile the odds. Thank you so much.
Only I would like to have the words. I mean, the
poem. All right. Yes, sir.
Yeah, send it to my mail.
All right, sir.
Thank you so much. So another person wants to render us. I don't. Babusha, who is the person? Yeah, please tell us what you want to give us.
I think just a few people were not around earlier when we had the presentation.
You had it already?
Yes.
What presentation?
They're going to play.
Okay, you already did it. So why are you doing it again?
The video for you to see, and the people were absent.
Okay. She doesn't. All right. What is it? We want to tell, give us a gist, just like she did. He did. He gave us an idea of what he's doing. You want to tell us what's happening?
Okay. So what happened today? I was sitting with her, and she was talking
with her.
And she was talking to me about what I could do with my talent. And I know I've been seeing a lot of people do the video thing on Facebook, and I'm like, I don't want to use this and just make people laugh. I want to send out a message. So she really spoke to me, and it got me. I went to talk to her. I know she writes poem, and I'm
Who's
like, peace. Sorry.
But you, why are you people? You know, it's disrespectful. Even when you people are talking about me, I was sitting here, and you'll be saying, he said. It's disrespectful to be talking to somebody who is present in a third person. And say, he said, you said, pastor said, or pastor referred to this, or pastor made a statement, or if you don't want to say pastor, say Sunday made a statement. You know, but it's not, that's better than saying that he said. But the thing is that it's not just you. Almost everybody does that. I just wonder, where is that coming from? You know, it's not right. People don't speak like that. And then, talking about Babusha, you are saying, also, I went to her. Who is her? Then you are saying, I went to her again. So I was thinking you are still talking about Babusha. This is another her again. But what? Don't just assume. Be here and in the now. Be level-headed. You know. Be structured in your language, in your state, in your talk.
So I'm going to peace the lady who has been writing, and I know she's a poet. Peace is a poet, and I needed peace to help me with the language.
You could now say
I needed her to help me with my life. So when we were in the room, we actually wrote a poem immediately and were able to do something with it. But then I was like, the poem we wrote was not, it would not fit here. So I wanted a message to be sent as regards what we're doing here. And so we had a drama about three categories of people that will probably be leaving here tomorrow. So it was like a message, a reminder that we should not leave here empty, or we should not leave here killing whatever we have learned. So it's just a short drama.
How many minutes?
4 minutes.
Okay, good. It's good that it's short. Thank you, thank you. What's your name again?
Adiola.
Adiola.
I don't just want to live here with all these things and yet I know nothing to do. just going to be a roadblock, but a dedication to hard work. Yes, yes. I choose not to rest. I make up my mind not to rest until I see my best.
So, it was just a little video, a short video.
I recognize myself.
So, it was just a short video because when we started, I heard somebody saying, where did they get the time? How do they rehearse? Who wrote the lines? We need to control our time. We controlled our time. That's why we could actually come up with this. And acting is, when I was sitting there, I told myself that actually acting is me practicalizing what I know, helping people to bring their message into a picture. I'm sure if I asked you what was the second line in this drama, you remember. But if I ask you what's the second statement he made today, you won't. So it sticks there. And I'm trying to say this now, put it in your life. What we have learned today, until you start to dramatize it, you would forget. Thank you, sir.
That is definitely one of the areas that we have to major in as we are planning to go to Africa. Because we have to look at all various ways and styles and genres and strategies and methods to use to bring the message to the masses where they are. And definitely theater and acting and movies, cinemas will be one of the major ways where we could bring this to pass. So, yes, so I want you people to already begin, if anyone that is gifted in these areas, I think we should begin to write scenarios on different messages. Mm-hmm. So that, because I can talk and preach, but there are some people that might not be the way they receive best. And then, just like Diola has said, you will not remember even the second line of what I have said. But most likely when it's acting and it's visual and it's audio at the same time and it's impressional and it's emotional and it's reacting on you and touching you on different levels at the same time. When talk is just touching you through the air. So that is what makes theater and acting and film to be much more memorable and powerful because people remember it. I think that is one thing that we should use not just here, but that's one thing that I'm thinking about and that I think we should. Anybody that wants to contribute or be a part of the HMT in Nigeria, or not HMT, Nigerian project, Nigerian transformation project, that is one thing that we will all need to work on. So, if you are gifted in that area, think about it and see what you could contribute. Not just in the area of theater, but maybe in other areas. And poems and things like that. Anything that could help people to get the message that we are communicating. We want to change Nigeria and Africa, but starting from Nigeria, from head to toe. We want to bring about transformation in Nigeria, which is going to be holistic. Tomorrow will be the day dedicated to Nigeria. From the morning, we will have the film, we will do the presentation we have to find a way to get the Facebook people to have the quality as well and to see it so that they'll, you know, either we have to put it near the camera or the something, I don't know, but so that they will not be left out. We are going to do a presentation about the Nigerian Transformation Project. I have a great challenge before me and a great task ahead of me. This time, while I'm still here now, is my time of rest and my time of freedom. It's my time of freedom, and it's also my time of rest, no problem. So, but my real problems and troubles and challenges will begin when I go to Nigeria. That is when I don't have problems now. That's when problems will start. I am not working now. That's when work will start. So, I have a great task ahead of me. And I'm not frightened by it. I'm not perturbed by the challenges. I'm not afraid that things are getting worse. People are telling me I should talk about the economic recession, about whatever. We are not going to talk. We are going to change Nigeria. I'm not going to try. It's going to happen. So it's not going to be an experiment. Nigeria is going to change. The only thing that might shake that a little bit is if I die too early. But if I have 5 years or 10 years, and I think I would not die because I know when I'm going to die. So I need 5 to 10 years. And I want to give freedom to everybody that wants to fight me now, and that wants to hate me, and that wants to do anything to hamper and hinder. Go ahead and do your worst. But if I am, by the grace of God, when God releases me from here to Nigeria, I need 5 to 10 years, and we're going to have a new nation. No shake, no doubt about it. We're going to have nothing less than a great nation. It's going to become the most important and the most famous, the most respected Christian country in the world. We are going to make it happen. Not in 10 years. 10 years, that would be enough for us to have stability and to have a new country. But to become the top country in the world before I die, that one will happen. Thank you. See you tomorrow. By the way, I forgot that you are here. I need to say bye-bye to you people too. So see you people tomorrow. I'll be back tomorrow and we'll be doing the presentation tomorrow. So go and share this link, go and share this message. Write your comments on them, write your reactions, what you think about this message. And and share with people. And tomorrow we'll continue in the morning. God bless you, good night.